Real quick before we get into the review, just gotta thank the people over on Patreon, because without their support, a lot of this upgraded content you see on the channel would not be possible. And I gotta say, on top of being able to respond to you guys in the DMs, you know, one of the fun things about the Patreon is every 3 months we do an anime and manga haul, and there's a lot of good goodies in that one. You also get sneak peeks at videos that haven't made their way onto the channel yet. I'm still figuring out what to do for actual YouTube memberships, so leave a suggestion down in the comment section below. But with that being said, thank you so much for all of you guys' support, and now let's get into the review. Yo, what's going on, everybody? It's your boy Naruto Explain here, bringing you guys a review for Boruto Chapter 56, and hands down, we really, really got to talk about all this new information that we got in the latest Boruto chapter. And I gotta say, for me, I'm pleasantly surprised that Masashi Kishimoto actually took this time to actually slow things down and begin the process of actually setting up something. That's one of the problems that I had with the previous work that was done under Kodachi, is that it really felt like we were getting like one arc after the other, and there wasn't real clear setup for a while. Once we got Kawaki introduced and you saw the car members, there wasn't really any development with the characters. And what we've seen with Code so far in the last couple of chapters is that the manga's starting to actually build off of information that the anime gave us. And that's something that Boruto as a series has lacked for a long time. For as powerful as Ishiki was, Ishiki, when it comes to his ideology, when it comes to his purpose, his personality, he was lacking. And so I think that by giving Code the personality of an Otsutsuki worshiper, somebody that is out to avenge Ishiki, have Code be somebody that we see his backstory. Code was one of the human beings that Jigen experimented on, trying to pass on Ishiki Otsutsuki's karma seal. And you get the revelation that Code was actually the person that Jigen tried to give the karma to. It didn't work. And unlike all the other humans that were given the karma seal that passed away, Code actually survived. But unlike Kawaki, who was able to actually take the karma seal and come out essentially unfazed, in the sense that he didn't die and didn't suffer any long-lasting damage, Code, on the other hand, Code is in a situation where his body was just put through the ringer, tortured. And it really makes you wonder if surviving in an ordeal like that, if that isn't part of the reason why he actually began to cling towards Ishiki Otsutsuki. And I could kind of see why. Once you go through a life-changing experience like that, it's one of those times where you tell yourself that in order to have survived all of this, you had to be here for some type of a purpose. And I think that's something that works right there. That's something to where I'm gonna be very interested to see if Code, if his character is fleshed out in that way. I think the anime has tried to actually start those building blocks, so I'm glad the manga's taking that plot point and the manga's actually moving that forward. So I thought that that was really nice right there. Now, what I do have to say though is that I like how once you get the actual beginning of the chapter, we get it where we find out that Kawaki's arm has been restored to full functionality by Amato, and you see everything that's being done, the checkups and everything. I like the small touches where, again, it's almost a little nod to what you saw in the anime, to where Kawaki and Sumire have a moment where she's trying to tend to him and he's a little bit resistant. But unlike in the anime where this dude is just knocking the food tray over and he's swapping hands with Sumire, we actually see how Kawaki allows himself to actually go through with the treatment. So that's development on the side of Kawaki right there. But the other thing I like though is that I like how you get this moment to where Amato says, like, I was able to prepare for this because Kawaki's body is different. I was able to take his own cells and I was able to engineer this new arm because of it. So a lot of people are saying, well, Naruto's chakra was what was connecting Kawaki's arm. Now we find out why Kawaki has a new arm during the time skip. So I like that that right there is actually addressed. I thought that was cool. You know, I gotta keep it real, man. Like, my unreliable narrator alarm is going off because it just seems like every time there's something super convenient for Amato to remember about Code and Jigen and the Otsutsuki clan, he just conveniently happens to remember something. Like, this whole time you're explaining all this stuff that we already knew about the Otsutsuki clan, you didn't happen to think, like, yeah, Kawaki's not the only person that has a karma seal. There's also this guy named Code, and oh yeah, this guy Code also has a variation of space-time ninjutsu, and so we really need to look out for something like that. And oh yeah, we also have to look out for the fact that, you know, Code is a Otsutsuki worshiper. And oh, I also have these cyborgs that I created from the bodies of all these people that I experimented on, and they're all more powerful than Jigen ever was, but I totally left all that out. That is so convenient. Like, my alarms that you cannot trust Amado, they continue to go off and off and off. This guy has a limiter built into Code's body. He has a limiter built into it. We know that he has a shutoff switch that is built into Delta. We saw it activated, but now you got people like Ada and all these others that are just sitting there, more powerful. It really makes me wonder if, like I said before, if Code is going to be revealed as simply a red herring and the true person we should have been paying attention to was going to be Amado. This is giving me the same vibes as Kabuto, when Kabuto gave all that intel on the Akatsuki to Konoha, and you saw that Kabuto's body had Orochimaru's DNA inside of it, and we didn't see Kabuto for a pretty significant portion of time after that. But the one thing that we knew is that Kabuto was out there somewhere. And we were paying all this attention to the Akatsuki and what Sasuke was doing and Tobi. And all of a sudden, that's when Kabuto got revealed. It's like, oh shoot, Kabuto has been building an Edo Tensei army in the shadows this whole time. I'm wondering if this is the route that is being taken now. That's something interesting right there. Something to kind of keep your eyes on. And the thing is I've seen people say you have all these androids. And you know, that's like another pet peeve of mine. They're making it clear these are human beings that have been augmented. Their bodies have been restructured with scientific tech. It's just like what you saw with Jinzo Ningen 17 and 18 from the Dragon Ball manga. Dr. Gero, if you'll remember, Dr. Gero had a cutoff switch for 17 and 18, much in the same way that Amado has a verbal cutoff switch with Delta. That's one of those things where, like I've said in the past, when you really sit down and you read Boruto, it isn't just through the poses and the action sequences, but there are other little small nods that are being made to the Dragon Ball franchise, and it makes sense because Ikimoto said in the past he references Dragon Ball a lot, and so that makes total sense right there. But you know, this dude Amado, to have all this stuff at his disposal and have all these cyborgs just laying around ready to be used, this is something troublesome right here. But it also opens up a door for Konoha to get a major weapons upgrade as well, if Amado is legit and if Amado is not killed by Code. If Amado is a legit ally to Konoha, I could see Amado upgrading Konoha and ultimately being killed off. I could see something like that happening. However, I digress, because we spent too much time on Amado and everything. That's really a video in of itself. But there's another interesting tidbit here. So you also have this moment where, you know, Kawaki looks over at Sumire, and my heart broke when this happened. So Sumire all of a sudden gets all flustered and frustrated. Her panties are getting wet because Kawaki says, "You like Boruto, don't you?" And I'm not a Borusaru shipper. That isn't what I am. I've been telling those people for a while. I said, "Hey man, this is ringing of Narusaku Part 2. I lived through it. I swear this feels like that's what it is." And I'm just going to say it right now, right? Like, when this happened right here, the reason why my heart sank is I hate the idea of Sumire being essentially reduced to being a love interest. She's just a more useful version of what Hinata was in Part 1. And I hate that. I hate that because I personally loved her anime backstory of her essentially following her father's will and in her father's footsteps and being converted and just seeing that extra metal, that extra gear, that edge in her. I thought that that was something really cool right there. I like how, you know, in the manga during the Ao arc, she has that line where she's like, yeah, Boruto's probably pretty popular with the girls. What I liked about it is that she was very straightforward. That was something I enjoyed a lot. And to see her kind of stumble into this scared, nervous dog type energy that you have here. I hate that. That's I absolutely hate that, man. Like, I'm a sucker for well-written and strong female characters, and that's something that I hated seeing right there. That's just my take on it. I know a lot of people like that character archetype. That's one of the ones I absolutely hate. So that's an automatic L for me personally. But what I will say, though, is that I like how you do see some development on that front, and then you see everything transition, and it's kind of crazy when you look at it, right? Like, you have Boruto being interviewed and praised as his hero, and I gotta say, man, like, the one thing that really stood out about this is that in the manga, so not the anime version, I know the anime did this to an extent, but since we're talking about the manga continuity, I'm gonna refer to the manga version. I like how in the manga continuity, you know, you get this moment where you see Naruto and Naruto's talking to the cameras and everything and talking about the importance of everything that happens and being a great ninja and etc. And what I like here is that, you know, when we get introduced to the Boruto story, that's what you see. That's one of the first images you see after Naruto and Boruto have that moment where Naruto's looking down at the ninja reports and everything and is awkward with Boruto, and Boruto walks out saying, "This is my story." What I like here is that it kind of pays homage to it. It brings it full circle. And what's so cool, in my opinion, of that is that just as the end of the Versus Momoshiki arc started a new beginning, you have Boruto now fulfilling both roles. He's fulfilling the role as the super popular figure in the village, but then you also have him sitting on top of the Hokage monument and making the vow to train. That's very cool right there. It's very cool to actually see both of those elements right there. So that's something interesting. I will say, I thought it was kind of funny to see Boruto in that position where he's downplaying his contributions and yet at the same time also carrying that huge burden of guilt that comes from knowing everything that happened. And Boruto, being the smart person he is, knows that essentially Konoha has him out on this press run in order to essentially keep the village in check and keep the village from getting too worried and to take their minds off of the information that they don't know, which is Boruto's 80% Otsutsuki, and that Boruto has this karma seal. I thought that that was a smart strategic play. And what I like is the fact that you're actually seeing that side of the Naruto franchise being played out. That is the type of stuff you actually see in the Shikamaru Shinden novel, A Cloud Drifting Through the Forlorn Hope. I thought that that was cool. I thought it was cool to see that. Now, what I will say, though, is that, you know, just looking at this from a art perspective, I had a few moments reading this where I thought that this is one of those times where it was a great idea, but I don't think it was executed to the best extent. I really feel like Ikimoto and whatever assistants he has that are doing the either the inking or touching up the panels, I really feel like this is one of those times where they really could have stayed in that moment a little bit more, because the eyes of a character conveys so much. And the thing about that is that a truly talented mangaka does not need to rely on the actual speech bubbles to convey the full emotion of what the characters are going through. The text is just something supplemental. And there have been times where I've seen Ikimoto's art and I feel like he's on the precipice of breaking through for something like that. And you can clearly see that is something that Ikimoto is trying to make an effort on, and you can just see hints of it beginning to bubble up. Like, that's the one thing I think that in year 5 of Boruto's run as a manga, that's the one area right there to where if he takes significant strides forward, that's gonna benefit the series a lot once you get to the time skip and you get the opportunity to start bringing in some of those fans that abandoned the manga, especially over there in Japan. In that interview right there, if you add in more of the subtle cues, maybe you show Boruto gripping the actual seat, you put a close-up on his actual hands gripping the seat of the couch, or I think for Ikimoto, finding that balance between being expressive and dynamic in the panel layout and the dialogue and the subtle interactions that the character has, finding that perfect balance right there. Once Ikimoto gets that, I really feel like the art's gonna take another step forward. Again, we can see some improvement. Like, Ikemoto's got some strong points. Like, I think we saw what was very close to a moment of brilliance when you had that moment when Boruto is in deep reflection and you have the Hokage monument shot. I think that that's one of those times where playing with the page spread could have done so much if you would have had a situation where, say for instance, you have Boruto on top of Naruto's Hokage head and you see how Boruto's just struggling with the weight of the thoughts that are going inside of his head. So symbolically, the way you do that is you have 80% of the double page spread with Boruto on top of the Hokage head, and then underneath that you have the reactions as far as like with Boruto's internal monologue, because what that shows you is that the thoughts that are weighing on Boruto are weighing on the actual thought panels that you have underneath that actual moment right there. If you have like Boruto looking down at his hand and then you have all that underneath it, that's something that can be done that further conveys the big moment that you have right there, as well as the severity of the character's internal conflict right there. That's why you hear me say a lot of times playing with the actual page panels. I know somebody's like, yo, that's a lot of time and effort. Okay, we've seen Ikemoto do that in the Versus Momoshiki arc, when you had that father-son Rasengan and you see the emotion on Boruto's face and on Naruto's face, and you see how all of those memories that Naruto's sharing with Boruto through his chakra, how all the memories are swirling around the actual Rasengan, and the way everything is structured, it has the Rasengan that Naruto and Boruto are forming basically be the center of the actual panel. I know Ikemoto can play around with his panels because we've seen it done. But moving on though, it's ironic that I transitioned here, because you also see how the narrative of everything that's going on is what's actually carrying the chapter, where you have the conversation where Kawaki is telling Boruto like, yo, you need to put the karma seal on code. You know, there was this one time where Jigen touched me and I didn't like that, but he also touched code and code totally liked that, to the point where code had like Stockholm syndrome and and code was in a situation where he said, touch me daddy, touch me, and he has the white karma seal and code is an incomplete vessel. But yo man, if you touch him the way that Jigen touched him, you can give him the karma seal as well, and if that happens, hey, you're gonna die anyway because Momoshiki's coming back, but yo, you'll be able to be reborn inside of him. Boruto, for the life of him, could never think of doing something like that. But I like how for that one moment, Boruto looks like he pauses, like he's thinking about it. He's thinking about it, and I like that, because that's a human response. Because human beings, at the end of the day, humans are gonna do what's in their best interest. It's just in our nature. And so what I like here is that you see that moment, but you see how Boruto embodies something that a lot of human beings should have, which is Boruto overcomes those urges and does the morally right thing, which is he's saying like, no, I'm just going to find a way to stop this dude. I'm not going to put a karma seal on him. I can't do that because I don't want to burden somebody with something like this. I like how you see Kawaki and Boruto and they have that moment where they're going back and forth over it, and I like that because it just shows you that Kawaki really cares about Boruto. He really cares about him a lot, enough so that he makes this suggestion, but at the same time it's just like, yo, the last chapter you said I'm gonna find a way to get the karma off of you, but I'm also gonna kill everybody that has the karma. And it's just like, yo, the thing that you hate, you're also telling Boruto to do the very thing that you hate. So it's a little contradictory, but that's one of those things where as human beings, we're contradictory by nature. And so that's one of those times where it's like, yo, I can kind of see what they're going for right there. Now, when it comes to Code himself, I thought it was kind of cool how, you know, Code absolutely washes those dudes outside of Boruto's hideout. And this is again one of those times where it's just like, I don't know what happened, but once they did the car actuation arc and the owl arc and they started fleshing out the car members, all of a sudden the manga is paying off stuff that the anime touched on, because it was heavily implied that Boruto was doing something outside of Jigen's wishes. And lo and behold, what we find out is that Boruto has been collecting all these cyborgs that were supposed to be destroyed. And it really makes me wonder, was the Kara organization is supposed to be even larger than what it is. Because for Jigen, a.k.a. Shikiosuke, to invest all of this time and money into a model to make all of these cyborgs, I really feel like this is one of those times where Kara was supposed to have a shit ton of inners, just like they have a lot of outers. But I like how we get the confirmation that, like, yo, if we get rid of all the inners, the outers are just going to scramble. And so if that happens, it's one of those times where now at this point, you just need to find the people that were affiliated. If you find the people that were affiliated, you're good. So that's interesting to see just that dynamic right there, that that's how Kara's actually structured, that it relies on those inners. But the fact is that we got Kashi and Koji out there somewhere. We don't know whether or not Delta's going to pop back up. And then you also have Code and you also have Ada at this point. I don't know if I'm saying her name right. It's ADA. But what I do like, though, is that, you know, Code watches those dudes. We see some of Code's abilities. And then you also see this moment to where after Code meets with Bug, he says, like, yo, Jigen's dead, Boro's probably dead, take me to actually go see this chick. And you see how that facility looks a lot like the facility in the Hidden Rain Village, and the anime is gonna kill this. And I've already seen people say, like, when you had the Kawaki versus Goro fight, how when you see how the stuff was adapted from the manga and all the small stuff that the anime did to flesh this out, it's one of those times where people say, Jesus Christ, I see what you're talking about. This is what I'm referring to right here. That next step forward for Ikimoto is going to be that. But I got to say, though, the raising of the tension here is one thing that actually works, where you have Naruto saying, I'm going to call a Five Kage Summit. I'm going to share the intel with the Kages. Now we have another opportunity for this to not be an action-heavy chapter, this next one, but another setup chapter. But what this next chapter is probably going to do is there's going to be open conflict and hostility between Naruto and the other Five Kage. Because Naruto last time said, like, yo, I'll take Kawaki into my possession. While I have him, there's nothing bad that's going to happen. If you'll recall, not all of the Kage were on board with not having Kawaki interrogated or executed. And so now that Boruto's 80% Otsutsuki, it's one of those times where, I said it before, somebody is going to make the suggestion of offing Boruto, or it's going to be very strongly implied. So it's going to be very interesting to see how Naruto handles that now that Naruto doesn't just have the Kyuubi to just smack people around. But overall, this was an okay chapter. I'm not going to say this was brilliant. I'm not going to say that. But I'm not going to say it's a bad chapter either. I would say this is a satisfactory chapter for a setup chapter. I think that, you know, we're seeing how the stakes are being raised without actual combat, which is something that the actual series needed, in my opinion. So my chapter question to you guys is, what are your thoughts about the fact that we have all these cyborgs out here that are stronger than Jigen? And in your opinion, do you side with me that when Amato says they're stronger than Jigen, they just mean stronger than Jigen as in before Ishiki is revived? I think that that's the case because there's a clear power creep. You have Jigen, who could only use part of Ishiki's power, and then you have Ishiki, who was reincarnated into Jigen. I think that there's a clear difference there. And if you say that these cyborgs are stronger than Jigen but weaker than Ishiki, I might be able to stomach a little bit more, but it's going to be very dependent on whether or not they have hacks abilities like Delta. However, let me know what you guys think down in the comment section below. But as always, guys, if you like anything I had to say, don't forget to comment, rate, subscribe, and share. Thank you so much for watching to the end. Have an awesome day, guys.